thank you so much. And again, welcome to all of you on such interesting 2 days, line of speakers. Thank you to City Events for organizing and bringing all this knowledge and information together. With me today is an excellent panel, an expert in their own areas in the fields. So let me go ahead and introduce the panel to all of you. So I have Mr. Egg. He's an executive chairman and founder for Eucharis Group Malaysia. Born in Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia in 1960, and he has received his education in SM Zing Zing and Victoria Institute. With over 30 years in microelectronics, telecommunication, internet, private equity fund management, family office fund, medical online healthcare, IoT, blockchain, artificial intelligence industry, he has done almost everything in terms of technology and microelectronics. He started his career in Silicon Valley, California as R&D engineer and has developed VLSI layout, verification of DRC, ERD tools, place root tools, and also developed second generation digital simulator DSLI that run 100 times faster than DSLI. And he has founded many big organizations and now heading Eucharist. So we'll welcome Dr. Egg. Also with me is Dr. John Perry. He is clinical director, clinical safety office, and data protection officer for TPP. He graduated from Cambridge University and was on NHS GP for 30 years. His areas of interest are health informatics and healthcare system, on how comprehensive shared electronic patient records can provide information from cradle to grave and supports a safer practice, information governance, data protection, big data research, and the structure of electronic clinical records. He has worked with his colleagues across UK, Gulf, Malaysia, and China. So welcome to the panel, Dr. Perry. I have with me Dr. Gaurav. You had a pleasure of listening to him right before this panel, and I think he threw excellent light on the culture of patient safety. And he has been leading the quality mandate for one of the largest hospital group in India, Apollo Hospital, and he has been a JCI surveyor. He's a master black belt, Lean Six Sigma. Gaurav has been a healthcare management professional from over 16 years of experience in hospitals, ambulatory care clinics, healthcare IT and consulting projects. Mr. Lauria has advocated special quality improvement, cost efficiency, revenue generation, and lean management projects across all the departments in various hospitals and ambulatory care centers. Gaurav has authored a fiction, Conditions Apply, in many articles, case studies, and books on tracers, quality improvement initiatives. He has won many awards, such as Hall of Fame, Top Quality Professionals in World Citation, Young Leader Award, besides many hospital management, Asia Federation of Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, IHF Award, and other awards for several innovations. You look like a celebrity. You have so many awards. My God. So happy to have you on the forum. And hey there, Manisha.
Yes, hi. Hi, Sid. I hope I'm audible.
Perfect. Happy to have you online. So everyone, here is Manisha Kumar. She's working as Regional Chief Operating Officer at Healthcare Global Enterprises in India. Manisha Kumar has an extensive experience heading large specialty hospital across the country. She's known for expertise in healthcare business turnaround and startup and growth strategy. She has been responsible for turning around a hospital business with turnover of about 100 million US and has been responsible for starting 210-bedded super specialty hospital and breaking even in 11 months. That's an achievement, Manisha. Congratulations to you. You have been turning around hospitals and breaking even so fast.
Thank you.
She is an MBA from Indian School of Business and started her business career early. She's part of several healthcare think tanks and is a representative in many national and international speaker forums. And she also has been deeply involved in managing COVID scenario with the government, her state, in the last 2 years. She has actively guides young and enterprising women in the industry and mentors startups in the healthcare spaces. So welcome to the forum, Manisha. So now let's just dive in, everyone in here. And the topic of the discussion today is very interesting. So We had previous two speakers who spoke about patient safety culture, nursing safe practices, and everything that revolves around bringing the safety at the most important part of the healthcare delivery system. One of the key things that we would want to focus at this point of time today is patient communications. So as all of you know, when we visit a hospital, when we visit a physician, when we go inside and talk to the nurses, there is an exchange of information that is happening in every time we are interacting with every stakeholder in the hospital. And when this exchange of information is happening, it may be clinical or non-clinical in nature. And the most important part of this exchange of information is it has to be accurate and timely delivered to the patient. And this is one of the key features of a patient safety culture in the hospital. Right communication to right patient at the right time. So now we are going to focus and ask our experts on what are their views about bringing in better patient communication strategies in the hospital and influencing a patient safety culture, both inside and outside hospital. We'll also be touching the digital part of patient safety, Mr. Egg, and we'll be happy to hear from you. So let me ask you this, most of the time when we talk about patient safety and communication, we visualize hospitals. We visualize a doctor and a patient sitting in the room and talking to each other face to face. With the advancement of digital technologies, this communication is moving out of the hospital. This is going on to telemedicine platforms. This is going into emails, SMS, and use of digital technologies. What would be your first view on this? So how can we make sure that patient communication and patient safety are synchronized together?
Thank you, Sid. Your introduction of me made me sound like a technical nerd earlier. You have a very good question. Today, most of the communications between doctors and patients are in a clinic face-to-face or in a hospital face-to-face. Now, with the digital platform, telemedicine, that becomes actually a big challenge. So we do have quite a number of patients that we have on a regular basis being managed by the doctors. In my mind, there are four areas that we have to look at and make sure that these four areas are fully covered. Number one is the basic infrastructure security that has to be there. So we go through quite a bit of our extensive cybersecurity checks and software and hardware put in place to ensure that the communication between the doctor from the server side or from the app or from the PC side to the patients at the other end fully secured. So that's the infrastructure security that has to be in place. That's number one. Number two is we want to make sure that the data that the content that's communicated to the patient is accurate. So accuracy is important. So in our systems, what we do is that we have all this data that's generated, whether by the hospital, by the labs, by the imaging centers, they're all fully loaded into the system. If you look at a lot of the hospital data today in the HIS system or the EMR, many of the data is not there. We went through all kinds of technology to make sure that, for example, the ECG that's coming up from the ECG machine, they are also loaded in the digital form in the EMR. The third is to make sure that you have full access to all the data that you have. So that gives you the full transparency. Now, if you look at the current practice right now, doctors are writing their doctor's notes and you don't get to see it. So in our system, doctor's notes, whatever that's in there, patient have full access of it. So by doing so, you give the full transparency to the patient. The idea there is to avoid doctors for not telling the patients what the real situation is. Now, a lot of doctors that I talk to, they are in the view that sometimes it's better not to tell the patient of certain critical diseases. Could be bad news, could be making the patients more upset or more worried. From our perspective is that if you start right at the beginning, from the time that you go through the normal health screening and eventually you identify there's disease, for example, cancer. Cancer is the one that's pretty much difficult for any patient to accept. So if you go through the whole process right at the beginning, from the screening and step by step, if you go through that, then I think it's easier for the patients to accept. And then lastly, of course, is to make sure that you communicate clearly. Now, with the digital platform these days, you have the voice, you have the video. I guess that actually helps a lot. Now, we do put in the AI of voice, such that, you know, the communications that's coming from the patient, a lot of times, some of them do not speak properly, or in fact, they are not in a good mood of speaking, or maybe they're drowsy. So the system has to be able to detect that and inform the doctor of the conditions of the patient that are in. So you need all those four areas to make sure that the system is robust enough to ensure that the communication is clear. Now, this is one way, going from the doctor to the patient, but the other way is also true, right? You also need to have the patients on a regular basis to give you enough information, including, for example, on a regular basis, in our systems, we allow the patient to actually track the symptoms that they have on a daily basis, if there is a symptoms. We did this actually because of the COVID. You know, at the time when COVID just started, you look for certain symptoms. If you have these symptoms, you're supposed to run your test, your PCR test and whatnot, right? So we started with that. Then we expanded that to pretty much most of the critical diseases. So you want the feedback also from the other end so that the doctor is actually on top of the situation of the patients. So that's the technology that's needed, and those are the few things that I think that would help the communications to the patient. Now, in the U.S., there's a HIPAA protocol that the doctors in the U.S. would adhere to and make sure that that is also followed in our system. So we started off with the HIPAA as a baseline communication protocol.
Excellent point, Mr. Egg. And I think care coordination and accuracy in communication, as you highlighted, are some of the key things when we are doing digital communication with the patients and the patients who are not sitting in front of us. I actually wanted to have a question for John. John, I was reading a survey published in UK by UK Healthcare Adult Survey something from the period of March to December 2020. And it mentions that 97% of the patients used digital mediums for their communication. And most of them either were booking appointments, ordering refills, getting their reports, or accessing EMRs. So that was quite an interesting digital enablement as part of patient communication. Now, in line with this, I actually wanted to broach a topic on how we can utilize research-based strategies to shape the materials and products and to select the channels that deliver them to the intended audiences. So how do we work on that? What would be your thoughts on that?
I've now got all the microphones, so I'm now going to take over. Excellent. We've heard a great deal this afternoon on patient safety and heard some really good talks, and I couldn't agree more with what you said so far. I think in the UK we have a strong culture of supporting healthcare with digital platforms. But you're right, the best way of doing this, I think, is still open for debate. I would recommend to those that are interested in how you define channels to use and mechanisms to use, there's a very good review by the Health Foundation in 2015 called Behavioral Insights in Healthcare. And it's talking about nudge approaches to delivering improved healthcare and ensuring that people take up the healthcare that they need. And a lot of them, I think we've probably heard some of already this afternoon, because they around framing the correct health message to make sure that it's delivered in the right format. Simple information design, getting stuff in the right language and in the simple language for the recipient. Prompts, cues and reminders. We have helped the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine to do some research in sending text messages to remind people to come for their flu jabs. And the evidence is that the more personalised you make that message, the more likely you are to get a response, because people need to feel that the message is coming to them personally. Obviously, health systems need defaults that are safe. And of course, again, in the UK, many of the systems have financial incentives built into the process as well. So I think there is no simple answer to the question as to how we should ensure that people are maximising the digital channels. But I would go further than my colleague on the right, in that I think the time is now where all of the citizens' data, all of the healthcare data from all of their healthcare providers should be within one record. You mentioned transparency, and I couldn't agree with you more. There's the transparency of care when a patient moves from provider to provider, and there is the transparency of care from the providers to the patient. And I think those two transitions, or those two transparencies, are the most important aspect to improving patient safety.
I think the microphone mics have lost the battery. But I think excellent observation, Dr. John. And I would actually want to add, so I started with Mr. Egg saying accuracy and coordination. And the third element I would want to add would be the transparency, as you mentioned just now. And I think these three are the key pillars of right patient communication strategy, no matter which platform you're using, which way you're using, which language. And I think building important communications in different language, the language which patient can understand, is one of the key to the entire patient communication strategy. Gaurav, if I can extend this conversation, and you have been leading such a big group of hospital for quality, you have been head of operations. I mean, issues arising out of patient communications many times land up into medical legal cases, and you know, clinicians being disturbed in their practices and things like that. So, and all this comes out of the patient reading their stuff from internet and coming and talking to either the hospital operations person or the physicians. So to what extent can internet access, media exposure, and cultural competency we can inculcate inside the hospital to build a patient-centricity culture? What would be your views on that?
Thank you for that question. I think you've been hearing a lot of data points, and just now one more data point was told. So I'd just like to extend on that. If we look at, you know, some of the data points or the researches that have been done, about 25 to 30% of the conversations on social media being on health issues. And in a survey, that 90% of 18 to 24 years of aged individuals, they rely completely on what social media says on health concerns. And we all would understand the fact that it can, or most of the times it's dangerous as well. Because if you just Google, you have got skin rashes, you may end up with skin cancer. So I think it's important that, you know, we need to understand the benefits and to what level are we utilizing these benefits of internet and social media, especially when it comes to healthcare. It's not about a product which can be told that, you know, okay, this is good, this is not good, but it's largely about our own individuals, our bodies and our health. With that, I think we also need to understand and appreciate the fact that we are in the era of convergence on patient centricity. And patient centricity is all about listening, defining, crafting, making, creating programs and implementing them, which is beneficial for the patients and their families. Now, when it comes to patients and their families, it's equally important that we look at their journeys in our hospital. You know, before they approach the healthcare institutions, whether it is through an online application or whether it could just be a query on a website or a normal call. From that level to patient's journey in the hospital and post-discharge and post-care, you know, how this whole framework works. So I think we really need to understand these patient journeys on, you know, how can these be helpful to us. One of the benefits of understanding these patient journeys is also creating those kind of online groups, which could be one big beneficial or, you know, the outcome of the internet and social media. You know, creating groups for patients who have had cancer, creating groups for patients who are on dialysis, who are on chemotherapy. This really helps people to connect with each other, understand that, hey, you know, I'm not the only one in this disease, and, you know, there are others also who have gone through it successfully. So even I can do it. This really builds, boosts up a lot of confidence and, you know, motivation of patients, because it's only they who can understand when they are going through such a devastating time. Last but not the least, as far as families are concerned, I think it's also equally important that they take the responsibility. So in some way or the other, we start utilizing this to change the culture, to talk about, you know, modification, for them to understand how important it is, for them to ask their healthcare provider, what does this procedure or surgery mean? Ask, if they are asked to sign a consent, what does the consent mean? Ask if it's the right site of my surgery that's gonna be taken up in the, you know, theater. So there are these very simple, basic questions which may be very evident sometimes in fully developed nations like US, but may not be asked in, you know, many other countries across the world. Because patients feel that doctors are gods and, you know, whatever they do is right. But I think it's important also to acknowledge and appreciate and understand that even they can commit mistakes. They are humans at the end of the day. And we need to help them, because it is about us, about our healthcare. So I think we need to be partners with them in providing healthcare to us, when whether it is doctors, nurses, or the whole healthcare team. So we need to work together as a team to make sure that our issues are resolved.
Excellent, excellent observation, Gaurav. So if I take this discussion forward, so Mr. Ek spoke about accessibility and coordination, then John spoke about transparency. You have taken it to a step further. The right to ask is what patient is not practicing in many LMIC countries, low to medium income group countries. And if the right to ask can be inculcated in these patients, and with this right to ask, when the patient asks the questions about surgery, about their education post-surgery, I think that will be a very good initiative in terms of how he can handle his communication related to his disease. I think excellent point, excellent point. Manisha, can you hear us?
Yes, Siddharth.
Perfect, perfect. So if you would have heard Dr. Gaurav spoke about journey of the patient, and in journey of the patient, he also mentioned about a cancer patient's journey, which is long, treacherous, and with the advance of medicine, it has become less risky and a very positive outcome focused. And you are leading such a big institute as a regional director. So what would be your views on patient safety in single specialty centers, like as an oncology center you are, and what it means, and how do you inculcate it across your team?
Thank you, Siddharth. I'm happy to join this conference. Would have liked much more. Fortunately, couldn't make it. But nice interacting with everybody out there. Very pertinent question for us in oncology, because we have patients who are very vulnerable, who are terminal, oftentimes immunosuppressed throughout the, you know, length of their journey in the hospitals and outside. They're fragile, vulnerable both physically and mentally. So it's all the more important that we keep them informed and we take care of their safety when they're in the hospital and also when they're outside. So talking in terms of, you know, oncology care and what it means for us to have effective communication with patients to ensure their safety, You know, how I'll do it is I'll just break it in three parts. And I think first and most important is communication within our teams, teams that are looking after our patients. So whether it is the clinical teams, the nurses, doctors, paramedical team, and so on. A couple of things that we do is one is we have multidisciplinary approach to treating our patients. We have all the set of doctors who are involved in diagnosis, you know, the nuclear medicine specialist, the radiologist, then the primary clinician with all the other oncologists who are supporting and allied. So it would be the radiation, radiotherapist, the medical oncologist, surgical oncologist. They all come together and through a concerted deliberation discussion, decide the course of treatment of the patient. And the same way, it is communicated to the patient and the patient party, including the family, in a very cohesive way. This ensures that all the clinical teams are on the same page. There is homogeneity of care that is maintained all throughout the patient is admitted or as many times he or she comes to the hospital. There is clear, transparent communication, and there are no, you know, very reduced margin of error between handover and takeover between various clinical teams at the hospital. We also do, you know, interdisciplinary rounds. All the clinical teams, more or less, as best possible, go and visit patients once or twice in a day together so that they can view the situation of the patient, decide the next course of action, explain prognosis, and so on. Second thing that we do and very religiously do is codify as much as possible and document as much as possible in our hospital information system. It could be something very simple as handing, taking over between, you know, nurses coming in different shifts. But this information is also very critical and of paramount importance. Any small nick of information missed can lead to a medication error. So therefore, it is information with great gravity and ensure that it's codified, whether it is, you know, handing over and taking over between doctors, between two shifts, between nurses, paramedics, and so on. Secondly, I would say communication to patients and patient families. Right from the time they touch base, there are various touch points throughout their journey in the hospital. But right from the time they come to, say, an outpatient area, you know, the first service line manager that they meet, nurse navigator, nurse practitioner that they meet, to the time they get admitted. So all the, I think some of the panelists, Gaurav just now mentioned, what are the patient rights and responsibilities? You know, what are the some of the, you know, alarms that they can raise, questions that they can ask, and explanations from our side on protocols that they should observe to ensure their safety while they're at the hospital. They could be small things like, you know, using a grab bar when you go to the washroom, when to call a nurse, but a lot of this requires explanation when the patient is especially terminally ill or bedridden, febrile. And lastly, I would say communication to patients and their families post-discharge, because for us, you know, the patient life cycles spans much longer than after they have left the hospital. There are periodic intermittent interactions, there's follow-ups, you know, there could be annual nuclear medicine tests, PET-CTs, and so on. So establishing that out-of-hospital ecosystem for us, where we have continuous and consistent interaction with patients, we keep them updated, we give them consistent regular alerts on when they have to come for follow-up. We have a very strong comprehensive rehabilitation program that covers all aspects, not just physiotherapy, but also, you know, psychological therapy, you know, speech therapy, swallow therapy, diet, nutrition, all of that, so that the quality of life improves even after it consistently keeps improving after the patient has left the hospital. So this is a huge aspect of communication that we do after the patient goes from the hospital, so that the relapse, recurrence of events are reduced and the patient is safe when they're in the home environment as well.
Excellent point. Excellent point from Manisha. I think it started with accessibility and coordination. Then we went on talking about transparency. Then Gaurav established about the right to ask. And Manisha established a very important part of the patient communication, that how to make patient contribute to his care journey. How can he become part of a decision-making process whereby nurses, doctors, and he himself is sitting in here and looking for his entire chronic care management platform, a chronic care management, which is a long cycle for the patient. And if he himself becomes a contributor, if he himself plays an active role in that, then patient would be communicated and he will be updated about his clinical conditions most of the time. Now, this is all we have been talking about, the hospitals and physician interactions and how in hospitals this should happen, you know. And mostly, most of the hospitals have been using physical communications and paper mediums as means of communication for the patient. I would actually invite the panelists to hear their views on how these digital technologies, artificial intelligence, communications of vitals through watches, SMS, how are they playing a role in patient safety and right patient communication? So maybe we can start with Mr. Egg. What would be your views outside or inside hospital, Mr. Egg?
Outside of hospital, obviously, it's much more challenging for a doctor to communicate to a patient who is remote. The only media that you have right now is the internet, the video conference, and all that, which if you look at all the telemedicine platform, they all have these features. Now, from my perspective, I don't think that's sufficient. If you seriously look at, you know, some of the miscommunication or bad communications between doctor face-to-face with the patients, there are a few areas that affects how the communication goes. One is, you know, it's hate to say this, but it's actually the attitude of the doctors, right? Do you actually spend time? Do you have the patience to speak to the the patients? Sorry, there's a fly flying around here. Now, the other thing is, you know, if you have been a doctor working for like 16 hours for the day, towards the end of the day, I don't think you feel excited about talking to the patients. It's the fatigue of the doctor at the end of the day or working for 20 years that makes it actually not exciting for the, or not passionate enough for the doctors to speak to the patients. So to me, all this can be probably make better and through the system, through the use of technology, such that the doctors would have to then adhere to the protocol. You have a set of protocols with the technology, with the systems, with AI or IoT, whatever that you need to put in place is to help the doctor to communicate fully, following the protocol that is already established in the hospital. When you speak to communicate to the patients online, you would have to do the same thing as well. So the best way of making sure that all things are done, just like in a factory, you worry about the operator making mistake in the production line, is to automate it, right? Make it just like the computers. You want to make sure that the user don't cause a crash on the systems or hang on the system, to make it idiot-proof, right? So apart from the infrastructure, the media and all that, the more important thing is to put together a system such that it's idiot-proof for the doctors to talk to the patient. Thank you.
Perfect. I think the robustness of the system is a key ingredient. John, you would want to contribute some?
Yeah, I think I'll go a little bit further. Actually making sure that the information, the data that the patient is generating comes into a single EMR where there can be the use of decision support, clinical decision support. All that data will lend itself to machine learning so that over time you will develop new algorithms of care, which will then be reflected back in using patient apps to patients. So I think what I'm trying to get to is I believe we are too doctor-centric. There are not enough doctors in most societies to cover all of healthcare as we're living longer. We have more and more long-term conditions. So actually putting, activating the citizen to take responsibility for the care, but giving them the opportunity to provide the data sets that are pertinent to the particular condition they've got, that data coming into an EMR system where the expert physicians can set the parameters for further intervention and reflecting that back through the patient app, through the decision support built into the patient app, so that actually the patient can take much greater responsibility for their care and reduce the burden, perhaps that's a poor word, but the burden on the healthcare system for people who are quite capable of looking after their own care.
Absolutely. In fact, as part of VMware, we are a hardcore IT organization, and we are working on top of some of these projects in NHS together with various providers. And I think NHS is doing an excellent work on building this data sets and making patients more active. Gaurav, would you want to contribute your thoughts on this?
Sure, thanks. So Steve Jobs once said that, you know, the biggest innovation of 21st century would be the intersection of biology and technology. So I think that's what we are talking about, and that's what we are aiming towards. You know, if we look at the advantages of, you know, moving in this direction, obviously, some of the examples which were previously given, it's like, you know, for example, getting a cardiac risk score whenever you do a health check to understand at what stage of risk are you to develop or have a heart-related condition or a heart attack in the next 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years down the line. And something similar could be an acute brain stroke, you know, using artificial intelligence and ML that we use. It could be patients who are sitting at home and then, you know, who has some leads connected to his heart or has just wearing a watch or something like that, a wearable wherein a person sitting in the in the hospital identifies that this patient has got is having irregular rhythms and, you know, could get into a MI, and so I need to immediately rush the ambulance to his house. You know, so there are different levels of advancements that are happening in technology, but I would just like to end here saying that, you know, we should not also forget that I always look at, you know, something like a product or a manufacturing based industry, then you have the service industries, and then you have healthcare. I really don't believe that healthcare is one of the service industries. It is something very different from even a service industry. And in such industries or in such a space, I think we should not forget that human touch is equally important. However far we go ahead in technology, but human touch is somewhere or the other really critical. As far as healthcare is concerned, be it just a doctor putting a hand on your shoulder and saying that, don't worry, I'll take care of you. And, you know, that's the confidence which the patients need when they walk into any hospital because they have a difficult situation. So that would be from my end.
Absolutely. Care and healing are two different things. So healing happens when you have a human touch. Manisha, any final thoughts from you?
Yeah, Sid. So I think most of the panelists have covered as to why, and yourself as well, as to why digital technology is needed in this, what is the use case. I'll just add some of the applications that we've used and how that has helped us. One of the things that we have done in our hospital is set up a centralized help desk system for patients. I think where patients, admitted patients, miss out is they don't know what is the escalation process in a hospital. They know that the first point of contact is probably the nurse or, you know, somebody, the caregiver, which is next to their bed or on the floor. But how does the escalation work if their request or concern or question is not met? They're not aware of that. So we put a smart system by which it's an app, really, which is available by the bedside of the patient. The patient can use it and raise any sort of request or question, clinical, not clinical. And then, you know, there are various levels. There is a person who is the first respondent for it, who's closest to the patient of that particular domain or department. And with time thresholds, there is an escalation matrix in case it is not closed. So that is something we've done. And we've seen that in terms of data, that there's been improvement, definite improvement in patient satisfaction scores and on NPS scores. We monitor it rigorously with external agencies. There has also been reduction in certain events, adverse and near miss events. And this has been a very powerful technology, simple but powerful, that we've implemented. The other bit that we've done is we've made a smart app for our HIS, hospital information system, access of which we've given to our doctors and nurses. This is a homegrown system. We've used technology providers to build it for us, and this app using API is synced with our HIS now. And the doctors as well as nurses, senior nurses from anywhere in the environment of the hospital or even outside, even the middle of the night, can write notes on it, can write tests on it, can view reports of the patient. So there is seamless connectivity of all patient records, which can be viewed by them at any point of time, so that the decision making is very precise and accurate, and no information in patient record is missed out. And lastly, something that we in HCG really emphasize on is research, is encouraging research findings. A lot of our clinicians are involved in writing papers with global doctors, with doctors in US. We have faculty that visits, our clinicians go there, they come here. And this kind of collaborative approach helps in using the information that is available to here to us here in our demographic, comparing it with theirs, and coming up with treatment plans and with findings that help to overall improve health outcomes for all our patients. So that is something we do.
Excellent, excellent. I have been instructed that we are running out of the time, and yep. Maybe coffee is warm, so yeah, we might have to take for a coffee break. But thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mr. Egg, John, Gaurav, and Manisha, for contributing your thoughts on the culture of patient safety through patient communications, and look forward to hearing from you back sometime.
Thank you. Thank you, Sid, and all the speakers.